In olden days, with literacy at its peak, dance was subjected only for the lower class courtesans, and the dance offered to please God by the Devdasis of Odisha. Fortunately, if we look back at the history of dance, we may find its root in the Skanda Puran, where Lord Shiva achieved enlightenment through dance. Let us talk about the story today. Daksha, the son of Brahma, offered the gods not only hymns but also his daughter's hand in marriage. His youngest daughter, however, was not interested in any Deva. She had given her heart to the mendicant called Shiva, much to her father's dismay. She left her father's side and followed Shiva wherever he went. She became his obedient consort, never questioning his actions, always by his side. She, therefore, became renowned as Sati, the perfect wife. Sati, perhaps, like many in the Vedic fold, questioned the orthodox ways that gave more importance to the mechanical execution of the ceremonies than to the needs of the heart and the questions of the mind. But Shiva's cold detachment from things worldly did not impress her either. She yearned for a middle path, where there was her husband's love and her father's affection. Once, Daksha organized a large yagna and invited all the gods to participate. Sati saw the gods and their wives making their way to the patriarch's house. To her great surprise, she and Shiva had been excluded from this elite gathering. Deciding that they had probably been left out, she decided that she would go. After all, it was her father's house. Shiva, though, was not sure that Daksha had actually meant to invite them to this yagna, and he expressed this to his wife. "No, it must have been an oversight," Sati insisted, unable to accept that her father did not want them to attend his yagna. Seeing Sati's determination, Shiva let her go, preferring to stay where he was. He shut his eyes and went into deep meditation. Sati reached her father's house. As she entered, she saw all the gods gathered there to receive the offerings of the yagna. She swept a glance around the huge pavilion and found that all the seats were occupied. There was no seat reserved for Shiva, her husband. Sati was upset and very angry. She realized that her father had purposely not extended an invitation to her lord. He had insulted her beloved Shiva. Her fury mounting, she turned questioning eyes upon her father. "Your husband is unworthy of any offering," her father calmly retorted. Sati gazed upon her father for a moment, her body trembling with rage and her eyes blazing like burning coals. Then she turned her back upon him, and before anyone could comprehend her intention, she leapt into the sacred fire, immolating herself. There was a shocked silence in the assembly. The gods looked on in dismay. The sacrificed precinct had been polluted and the yagna had to be halted, leaving it incomplete. In some narratives, Sati burns herself not by the external fire of her father's yagna, but by the inner flame she kindles by the mental concentration. She thus uses the aesthetic route to destroy her father's ritual. The death of Sati set the stage for the violent confrontation between the world rejecting Shiva and the world affirming Dakshin. Shiva experiences emotions that never had he felt before. There is loss, pain and rage. The fire withheld in his body for centuries explodes like a volcano of emotions, taking the form of Veerbhadra. The news of Sati's death at once reached Shiva at Mount Kailas. He was devastated. His wife's death broke his heart. His serenity had been shattered and he was enraged. His anger knew new bounds and he went into action. He was intent on taking revenge upon Daksha for the thoughtless action that led to the death of his beloved Sati, who was also Daksha's own daughter. In his fury, Shiva pulled out his hair, and from that hair he created a monster, a fanged warrior called Veerbhadra, whose sole purpose was to draw blood. Veerbhadra rushed to Daksha's house, followed by the Ganas, the hordes of ghosts and goblins riding on the rabid dogs. The gods were still assembled there, and the remains of the Yagna strewn around in mute testimony to its abrupt and ill-fated end. The air was filled with the howl of the death as the frightened gods stood by helplessly. Veerbhadra and the followers of Shiva went on a bloody rampage. They leapt on the assembled devas, ripping out their hearts and gorging their eyes. They drank their blood and bedecked themselves with limbs and entrails. The sacred precinct of the Yagna was transformed into a gory killing field. Veerbhadra then looked for Daksha, his chosen target. He saw him hiding behind the altar, stunned disbelief on his face. Veerbhadra rushed at him and with one mighty swoop of the axe, he beheaded Daksha. The noble head of the great patriarch was unceremoniously tossed and left lying at the altar. Having destroyed the Yagna, Veerbhadra returned to Shiva's abode. Sati had brought Shiva in touch with his feelings. In her company, he had experienced love. In her absence, he experienced sorrow. Her death made him realize the cruelty of the social rules and regulations that often ignore in the quest to establish order. His outrage manifested itself by overpowering need to destroy the very fabric of the society itself. His followers, the Ganas, spread mayhem wherever they went. They destroyed the Yagna and thus attacked the very foundations of the Vedic society. But the rage and retribution, the destruction of the society, did not take the pain away. Shiva clung to Sati's corpse and wandered across the three worlds, howling in agony. His tears turned into sacred beads known as the Rudraksha, meaning form from the eyes of Rudra, who is Shiva. The beads thus represent the reaction of Shiva when he finally came in touch with his samsara. Vishnu was alarmed. Shiva could not be consoled. He feared for the well-being of the cosmos. Shiva had to stop grieving. Vishnu raised his serrated discus, Sudarshana, that destroys all the negativity and hurled it in the air. It cut Sati's body into 108 pieces. The physical form of Sati did not exist anymore. With Sati's body gone, Shiva regained senses. He restored the goods to life and revived Daksha by placing his cut head with that of a goat. Daksha completed his yagna and empowered the devas so that the cycle of life could rotate once more. This time an offering was made to Shiva too, at the end of the ritual. Shiva let his dogs consume it. He simply withdrew into a cave, shut his eyes and immersed himself in his inner world, where he relit the fire of tapa and destroyed his ties with the outer world. Vishnu is that aspect of God that sustains order in nature and culture. while he could understand Shiva's rage against the nature of civilization, he could not let Shiva destroy the entire society. By destroying Sati's corpse, he was able to make Shiva detach himself from the stimulus of pain. With Sati gone, Shiva was able to overcome his grief and sense of loss. He could even let go of his outrage. He resurrected Daksha by replacing his head with a goat and let him continue as before, as the patriarch of the Vedic civilization. Shiva, however, remained an outsider. He disengaged himself from the world, seeking freedom from those stimuli that caused pain and suffering. Sitting peacefully atop Mount Kailash, he shut his eyes, withdrew his senses inward, relit the flames of tapa, and let his failures stir in self-contentment.